I started out actually in high school. I was a born again Christian. I accepted Christ as my Lord and Savior, as we used to say, and I became very committed as an evangelical Christian, and I went off to Moody Bible Institute for college, which is a fundamentalist Bible college. After that, I went to Wheaton College, which is a liberal arts college. It's Billy Graham's alma mater. It's an evangelical school. So I had very solid evangelical Christian commitments. And eventually, I got a seminary degree, and I was a pastor of a Baptist church for a year. But gradually, for a large number of reasons, I started to question some of the assumptions that I had about the faith. For a long time, I thought that the Bible was inspired and inerrant, that there were no mistakes in the Bible. But as I engaged in historical research on the Bible, as I was getting my PhD in New Testament studies at Princeton Theological Seminary, I started finding mistakes in the Bible. And this cut away at my assumptions that the Bible was inerrant. And then I started questioning other parts of my faith. Is Jesus really divine? Is there really a Trinity? It was difficult. I mean, if you're raised in the Christian tradition, this forms the very heart and soul of who you are. And leaving it means leaving friends. It means alienating family. It means losing out on all sorts of social networks that you have and all sorts of beliefs that you've held dear. And so it's very difficult and traumatic emotionally. But my view at the time was that I was in a search for what is true. And I came to believe it simply isn't true that the Bible's without error. And the idea that Jesus is God is an idea that was developed historically over time among Christians. It wasn't something that was original to Christianity. It's a later historical development. So too the doctrine of the Trinity. And these various ideas that I had held on to, I started to realize were historical formulations. And just the existence of God himself, I finally came to realize that for me, it simply didn't make sense anymore. Yeah, well, this is an interesting thing that we think when we read the Bible that we're obviously reading the words that Matthew wrote or that Paul wrote. But the reality is we don't have the originals of Matthew or of Paul's letters or of any other book of the New Testament or of the Old Testament. What we have are copies of these books that were made later, in many cases, many centuries later. So the New Testament was originally written in Greek, and at present we have something like 5,500 manuscripts in Greek of the New Testament, which is a lot for an ancient book. It's far more than any other ancient book. The problem is most of these copies are hundreds and hundreds of years after the originals, and all of them have differences in them. So that the scribes who were copying these manuscripts changed the text that they were copying, sometimes by accident. I mean, sometimes they just made mistakes. They were sleepy or incompetent or whatever. But sometimes it looks like scribes actually thought the text should say something other than it did, and then they would change the text. Some places it looks like it's a manipulation of the text, where the author wants to change, where the scribe wants to change what the author said. I mean, in many cases it may be that the scribe thought this is what the author really meant, and so he changed it. But sometimes the text gets changed to say just the opposite of what it originally said, and so that can be a little bit troubling. Yeah. Yeah, so the last 12 verses of Mark are they're very interesting. Jesus has been dead, he's been crucified, he's dead and been buried. And on the third day, the women go to the tomb to see about anointing his body for burial, but they find the tomb's empty. Jesus isn't there. There's a young man in the tomb who says that Jesus will go, they're supposed to go tell the disciples that Jesus will go before them and meet them in Galilee. The disciples are supposed to go to Galilee, and the women are supposed to tell them to go. And then it says the women fled from the tomb and didn't say anything to anyone because they were afraid. That's the end of Mark's gospel. It ends with the women not saying anything. Well, some scribes read this ending and thought, well, that's odd. I mean, the women didn't tell anybody. I mean, surely the disciples knew. And so so some scribes added a longer ending. So the last 12 verses are this longer ending where the women do go tell the disciples. They do go to Galilee. Jesus does meet them there. And this is the passage where Jesus tells his disciples that if anyone believes in his name, they'll be able to speak in foreign tongues. They'll be able to handle deadly snakes, and they won't. And they'll be able to drink poison, and it won't harm them. Hmm. And so these are the verses that the Appalachian snake handlers use to justify their ritual practice. Matthew and Luke have many of the stories in Mark, and sometimes they have the stories actually in the same words mm-hmm. as Mark. And for hundreds and hundreds of years, since the 4th century at least, biblical scholars have recognized that the reason they have so many of the stories in the same words is that somebody's copying somebody else. And so the idea is usually thought that Matthew and Luke actually copied some of their stories from Mark. That's why they're verbatim the same in so many places. One of the things that I've studied in a number of my books, including my book Lost Christianities and in my book Misquoting Jesus, is this phenomenon that I call proto-Orthodox Christianity. In early Christianity, there were a variety of Christian groups that believed a variety of things. Some of them that would seem wild and crazy to most Christians today. But there were battles for who would be right and who would be wrong and who would get the most converts and who would establish what the standard view would be. The standard view is called orthodoxy. The word orthodoxy means the correct belief. So the people who ended up winning these battles over what to believe called themselves orthodox, meaning they had the correct beliefs, and everyone else they called heretics. A heresy means choice. It's a choice not to believe the right things. And so proto-orthodoxy is what people were saying that led to orthodoxy before it was orthodoxy. Hmm. So you have a lot of different Christian groups saying a lot of different things. One of these groups wins out and calls itself orthodox. But what do you call this group before they win out? I call them proto-orthodox because they're representing the views that eventually are going to triumph in Christianity. Well, there are a lot of, you know, the proto-orthodox scribes are the ones who gave us these 5,500 manuscripts we have. If heretics copied the text and changed the text in a heretical way, those manuscripts apparently got destroyed. And so we have manuscripts then from the proto-Orthodox, and sometimes they changed the text in significant ways. I mean, as one example, there were debates in early Christianity about who Jesus was. Was he a human being who was chosen by God? Was he God who only seemed to be a human being? Was he both God and human? What was he? And scribes who knew about these debates would sometimes change the Gospels in order to make the Gospels reflect their own points of view. And so one of the arguments was, is Jesus really human or not? There's this famous passage in the Gospel of Luke where Jesus, before being arrested, sweats great drops as if of blood. So this is the bloody sweat. And this is where when people say, you know, he was sweating blood, that's what they're referring to is this passage. It turns out this passage was not originally in the Gospel of Luke. It's not in our oldest and best manuscripts of Luke. And it looks like the reason it's there now is because there were Christians who wanted to argue that Jesus was fully human. This was the Orthodox view. Jesus really was human. He